It's not always enough to say we want a block. We also define characteristics of the block, such as size, shape, and color. So too with an HTML element. We define an element's characteristics with HTML attributes. For example, here we have an input element. Recall that the browser displays an input element as a text box on the web page. We want to limit the number of characters that the user can type into that text box by adding the maxlength attribute, and require that the user type something into the text box by adding the required attribute. We define the attributes for any HTML element within the opening tag. We specify the attribute name in lowercase, an equal sign, and the attribute value in quotes. In this example, we limit the entry to only 5 characters. We separate multiple attributes for an element with a space. The required attribute is a bit different in that it doesn't need a value. We'll talk about its syntax shortly. Each HTML element has a predefined set of attributes. Those attributes provide identification or configuration information. Some attributes, like required, don't need a value. This type of attribute is sometimes called a Boolean attribute because a Boolean has only 2 possible values, true and false. If the element has the attribute is meant to be on or true, and if the attribute isn't added to the element, the attribute is off or false. We can write a Boolean attribute any of 3 ways: with an attribute name only, no equal sign, and no value in quotes. It can be defined with an empty value, or with a value that is the same as the attribute name. Each of these are valid syntax. Consider selecting one style and use it consistently throughout your website. I normally go with this first option, as it requires less typing. 2 common attributes you'll see on many HTML elements are the class and ID attributes. We use the class attribute to assign a style classification for the element. We'll talk more about styles in the CSS course later in this series. We give an element a unique identifier so we can reference it in other HTML, or in our CSS or JavaScript code, which we'll see later in this series. If you want to reference a specific HTML element, give it a unique identifier using the ID attribute. Here are a few tips for defining an ID attribute value. Be descriptive and unique. Use a value that clearly describes the purpose of the element, and make the ID value different from any other ID on your website. Use lowercase. Use a hyphen to separate words, not spaces. And don't add the ID attribute to an element unless you plan to use that ID. Let's look at an example of how we would use the ID attribute. The browser displays an input element as a text box. But how would the user know what to type in this box? We need a label. First, we give the input element an ID. Within the input element's opening tag, we specify the ID attribute, giving it a unique identifier. Then we add a label element and associate that label with the input, by setting the label's for attribute to the input element's ID. This defines the label for that input element, and the user now knows what they should type into the text box. Let's try it out. As we have our web page now, the user has no hint as to what to type into these boxes. Let's try out some attributes and add labels for these text boxes. If you still have your text editor open, that's great. If you've closed it, use your text editor and open the index.html file we created earlier, and open the file to view it in the browser. I still have my text editor here on the left and my browser on the right. For the first input element, let's start by adding an ID attribute. We type the name of the attribute, which is ID, then an equal sign, then we type the attribute value within quotation marks. The ID value should reflect the purpose of the text box. The first text box is for the username, so we'll set the ID to user-name. Don't forget the closing quote. Next, we'll mark it as a required entry box by adding the required attribute. Type a space, then required, all in lowercase. Recall that the required attribute does not need an assigned value. And then let's set a maximum entry of 12 characters using the maxlength attribute. Type a space and maxlength, all in lowercase. Then an equal sign, then the attribute value within quotation marks. We'll set it to a maximum entry length of 12. For the second input element, we'll just give it an ID. Type ID, an equal sign, and the attribute value in quotes. The second text box is for their favorite type of pet, so we'll set it to favorite-pet-type. Now that our text boxes have IDs, we can add a label element for each text box. Pause the video now if you want to give it a try on your own from the information we covered on the slides. Ready to see my solution? Within each paragraph, I added the label element above the input element. I set the label element for attribute to the ID we set in the input element, and set the label's contents to the text we want to display as the label. And don't forget the closing label tags. Save the document and refresh the browser to see the result. Cool! Now the user knows what is expected in each text box. And notice that if we click on the label, the input gets focus. That's because we associated the label with the input element. Nice! When we type a value into the first text box, the browser only allows us to enter 12 characters. So that works. However, the required attribute doesn't seem to do anything. It doesn't display a message when I move off the text box. That's because the required attribute only works when we submit a form to the web server. We'll talk more about forms a bit later in this course. We've tried out several attributes here, but how do we know what attributes are available for an element? Your best bet is the Mozilla Developer Network, or MDN, documentation. In the browser, click the plus to start a new tab. I'll maximize the browser for more space. In the address bar, type MDN and an element name. Let's try label. The developer.mozilla.org site should appear toward the top of the results. Click the link to navigate to the site. Here, the MDN documentation provides a general overview of the element, a place to try it out, and some details on using the element. Scrolling down, we see the attributes section. Here it links to global attributes that all elements have, and the list of attributes specific to this element, in this case, 4. There are also examples and more. On the left, you can navigate to other elements. Use the MDN documentation anytime you want information on an element or its attributes. I'll close this tab and reset my layout. Now let's go back to the slides. So, HTML attributes provide identification and configuration information for an HTML element. It may seem like a lot of new terms here, but the most important two to remember when working with HTML are element and attribute. We use elements with their attributes to mark up our documents so the browser knows how to display them. Most HTML elements have an opening tag with the element name, optionally one or more attributes within the opening tag, separated with a space. Most attributes have an attribute name, an equal sign, and the attribute value in quotation marks. The element has a closing tag with the element name. The stuff in between the opening and closing tag is the content of the element. Use the developer.mozilla.org website as a reference to find the list of all elements and their attributes. Now that we've covered the key HTML building blocks, elements and attributes, let's look at how to put them together to build a strong foundation for our web pages.